Hello everyone, good afternoon.
Hello.
Welcome to the second and final day of the international webinar on gender issues and women's rights, organized by the internal quality assurance cells of Acharya Sukumar Sen Mahavidyalaya, Purbo Bardhaman, and Birpara College, Alipurduar. This webinar is being held under the direction of the University Grants Commission. Due to a large number of participants, we are streaming the session on YouTube Live. Those who have joined on the first day itself will know. We thank the educational and cultural station of Ramakrishna Mission Vidya Mandir, Belur, for kindly providing us with this platform. Before moving on to the welcome address, I would like to take the opportunity of informing our participants of another event that we are going to organize on July 26, 2020. It will be an interactive session with psychiatrist Dr. Shuddhendu Chakraborty and clinical psychologist Srimati Totini Dotto on the topic De-stress in Distress, where the experts will tell us of ways in which we can tackle mental issues during the current pandemic. The interactive session will be streamed on YouTube Live, just like this session, from 3 p.m. on Sunday, July 26th. The registration form for Sunday's event will be posted on the chat box of today's session. We urge our participants to register for what promises to be a very interesting session. I now invite Dr. Dil Kumar Pradhan, the teacher in charge of Birpara College, to please give the welcome address. His constant support for our initiative has helped us overcome many obstacles on the way. Over to Dr. Pradhan.
Thank you, Dr. Nikhilesh Bhattacharji. I welcome you all to the second day of the international webinar on gender issues and women's rights. On behalf of Birpara College, let me say it gives us a great pleasure to work with Dr. Jayanta Mukherjee, the principal of Acharya Sukumar Sen Mahavidyalaya, and his team to bring you this webinar. I also thank Ramakrishna Mission Vivekananda Vidyalaya Belur for kindly providing us with this platform through its educational and cultural station. A special thanks are due to Sri Ramakrishna Mandal of ECS for managing all the technical aspects of the session. Today's program schedule has a young panel of academics. First up is Dr. Sneha Kar Chaudhary, Assistant Professor in Department of English, West Bengal State University. Unfortunately, because of technical difficulties, Dr. Kar Chaudhary is unable to join us today. However, she has kindly shared with us her presentation and paper, and the organizer will make the presentation on behalf of her. The second presentation of the day will be by Sushri Viveka Guru, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Narbadur Bhandari Degree College in East Sikkim. The final presentation will be made by Noor Rizvi, Doctoral Fellow at Aligarh Muslim University. I hope all of you will enjoy the session. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Pradhan, for your welcome address. To the participants, we apologize for the fact that Dr. Sneha Kaur Chaudhary could not be present today with us because of technical difficulties. However, we will make her presentation on her behalf because she has shared her presentation and PowerPoint with us. Dr. Sneha Kaur Chaudhary's research areas are 19th century literature, British and Anglophone postmodern fiction, Neo-Victorian studies, gender studies, adaptation studies, popular culture, and films. The title of her presentation today is Post-Feminism, Women-Centric Cinema, and the Ideological Contradictions of Bollywood Films. Since Dr. Chaudhary is not present, as I said, the questions directed at her will not be answered today. So I begin the presentation. I will also be sharing the screen, the PowerPoint presentation that she has given us. Kindly be a little patient. All these technical issues require a lot of multitasking. So if there are any hitches along the way, I just urge the participants to be patient with us. Thank you. I will start Sneha Kaur Chaudhuri's presentation now. I request Ramkrishna Mondol, who is backstage, to please share my screen. The webinar topic, of course, you know, this is gender issues and women's rights. And I present to you Dr. Sneha Kaur Chaudhuri's presentation titled Post-Feminism, Women-Centric Cinema and the Ideological Contradictions of Bollywood Films. Ever since cinema emerged as a profoundly important national popular domain, negotiating various conflicts and transitions in the political and socio-cultural fabric of India, woman has been represented as the vanguard of Indian tradition, culture, and values. The familiar opposition between the chaste heroine of Hindi cinema and the ultra-modern vamp has been its way of portraying the clash between tradition and modernity in Indian culture. The Bombay-based Hindi cinema, nevertheless, remained patriarchal and upheld the masculinist strategies of the modern nation. The concentrated focus on women as deciding the narrative structure and cultural import of films is a new development taking place largely in the last two decades of the new millennium. In the 1990s, women in the most popular of the NRI films figured to serve the interest of the hero for promoting cultural indigenism, or in narratives set in India, upheld traditional images of the good daughter of patriarchy, getting romantically rewarding in the end with the best guy. In fact, Bollywood films, as a global product from the mid-1990s, promoted films where the negotiations of the NRI hero with the global and the local cultures became a leitmotif of sorts. In such films, the pretty and demure heroine was invariably a passive partner in this cultural struggle. She loved, trusted, and supported the hero. But the selfhood of such romantic heroines was always circumscribed and determined by the dominance of their dashing, chivalric NRI lovers. As you can see on the screen, there are some posters of some of these films. This theme has been done to death in the next decade, and that led to the shrinking of the space given to the female leads in mainstream Bollywood films. Thus, female-oriented roles were few and far between, and such author-backed roles were meant for fewer actresses who were willing to enact such challenging roles, surrendering their commercial and mainstream images. I go to the next slide. Powerful women-centric films like Mrityudandan, 1997, Dushman, 1998, Astitva, 2000, Pizza, 2000, Lajja, 2001, Zubeda, also in 2001, Chandni Bar, 2001, and a few others were shouldered by the talented brigade of Rekha, Madhuri Dixit. I'll just pause the presentation for 2 seconds. Be with us. Yes, is there a problem? Is there a problem? Can anyone please tell me?
Properly screen test here, hoyni Nikhilesh da.
স্ক্রিনটা শেয়ার হয়নি? আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে,
স্ক্রিনটা শেয়ার হয়নি প্রপারলি। সাউন্ডটা এখন প্রপারলি স্ক্রিনটা এসছে, কিন্তু সাউন্ডটা স্যার আপনার এ করা আছে, মিউট করা আছে, সাউন্ডটা আনমিউট করতে হবে।
সরি,
ওকে ওকে, এবার ঠিক আছে, এবার ঠিক আছে, এবার ফুল স্লাইড শো করতে হবে।
শিওর, অ্যাপোলজিস টু দ্য পার্টিসিপেন্টস অ্যাগেন, just a few technical issues, we are trying to firefight as we go along. I'll start from before where I started, where I finished. This is the third slide where the paper says powerful women centric films like Mrityudand, Dushman, Astitva, Pizza, Lajja, Zubeda, Chandni Bar and a few others were shouldered by the talented brigade of Rekha, Madhuri Dixit, Monisha Koirala, Karishma Kapoor, Kajol and Tabu. But these films were still considered niche and less popular. Leading directors and producers were not willing to invest their creative energy and money on such less commercially viable ventures. Yet these spates of films at the turn of the millennium significantly underscored the potential of Bollywood's female leads that still needed more encouragement and support. Gradually, some filmmakers like Madhur Bhandarkar, Prakash Jha, among others, and many emerging female actors in the industry like Priyanka Chopra, Vidya Balan, whose photograph is on screen, and Kangana Ranaut, whose picture is also there, to name a few, wanted more meaty and meaningful roles in mainstream films that focused on women's issues and highlighted their socio-cultural struggles. I go to the next slide. The predominance of action films and romantic comedies performed by the three Khans, i.e. Aamir, Salman and Shah Rukh, did not allow the female actors to come to the forefront in their films. But the emergence of talented female actors like Balan and Ranaut have broken their male-centric tradition, and their initial films like Parinita 2005 and Fashion 2008 respectively received both commercial and critical acclaim. Even Rani Mukherjee and Preeti Zinta captivated the audiences with their history. Rime Daag and Heaven on Earth, proving that they were more than just arm candy to the three Khans. This acceptance of female-centric cinema by the audience and the confident talent of some lead female actors encouraged many new and established heroines to accept pivotal roles from directors and producers willing to project women-centric cinema. In the last decade, this female-centric trend has become a regular affair with actors, producers, and directors contributing to such films on a regular basis and usually getting rich dividends from them. Thus, the cultural import of Bollywood films in the last two decades has notably changed with its preponderance of women as lead characters in a traditionally masculinist industry. The emergence of post-feminism as a fundamental yet highly contested notion in the lexicon of feminist media and cultural studies has brought about decisive changes in the praxis of filmmaking. Post-feminism has no fixed meaning. It is a contradictory pluralistic discourse that is mainly located in the academic context of television and cultural studies, in the media context of popular culture, and within consumer culture. Since post-feminism is about feminism today, it needs to be situated in the contemporary context of neoliberal, late capitalist society characterized by consumer culture, individualism, postmodernism, and a decreased interest in institutional politics and activism. Post-feminism is a new form of empowerment and independence. Individual choice, sexual pleasure, consumer culture, fashion, hybridism, humor, and the renewed focus on the female body can be considered fundamental.
One second. Actually, slide ta move korche ra. Apni oi slide show ta on e korenni, click korenni.
Acha, right.
Okay.
Ami arekbar shuru korchi.
Ha ha ha.
Right. Is this visible now, Ramkrishna?
Ha 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 ha.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
না আমি যদি বলছি এক সেকেন্ড ওয়ান সেকেন্ড স্যার আপনি যদি স্লাইড শো মোডে দেন তাহলে ভালো হয়, তাহলে ফুল স্ক্রিন হয়।
আচ্ছা আমি কিন্তু এখন স্লাইড শোই সেটআপ করেছি।
না স্যার স্লাইড নিচের দিকে একদম নিচের দিকে দেখুন একটা ইয়ে আছে স্লাইড শো বলে, যেখানে আপনার ভলিউমটা রয়েছে তার পাশে।
আচ্ছা রাইট
একদম ক্লিক করুন।
হ্যাঁ এটা কি ঠিক হয়েছে এখন?
না ক্লিক করুন, ক্লিক হয়নি।
আচ্ছা
না চলে গেল কারসারটা পাশে। হ্যাঁ
ইয়েস এইটা তো স্লাইড শো। হ্যাঁ এবার আমি করেছি কিন্তু
করেছেন কিন্তু কোনো কারণে হচ্ছে না।
আচ্ছা কিছুই কি দেখা যাচ্ছে না? দেখা যাচ্ছে
স্লাইড দেখা যাচ্ছে কিন্তু ফুল স্ক্রিন হচ্ছে না।
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে, আশা করছি আমার স্ক্রিনে আর সেরকম কিছু নেই, আমরা এটা দিয়েই কাজ চালাচ্ছি।
হ্যাঁ এইভাবেই তাহলে নেক্সট করতে হবে। আপনার 7 স্লাইডটা দেখা যাচ্ছে এখন।
অলরাইট ওকে
স্যার।
It is a new critical understanding of the changed relations between feminism, popular culture, and femininity, as it involves a reconceptualizing of women's identity by renouncing essentialism and deconstructing authoritarian paradigms or fixed categories of gender and heteronormativity. Media discourses play a crucial role in the representation, evolution, and development of this new feminism. Bollywood's current focus on female empowerment is neither accidental nor purely entertainment oriented. It is consciously rooted at the confluence of the political, the civil, and the economic. We would situate just a minute, sorry. We would situate the study of the new Bollywood women in the larger context of the present government policies towards the realization of gender equality and women's rights. Bollywood, as the most influential culture industry of India, incorporates the current shifts in a global neoliberal India towards greater gender awareness. This shift is clearly indicated in the post-feminist redelineation of women's subjectivity in Bollywood films. In the past few years, while post-feminism celebrates women's body and personal rights as essential components of female subjectivity, the national policy for women focuses on trafficking, violence against women and Nari Adalats, surrogacy rights, vulnerabilities of single women, and advocates respect towards women's rights and body irrespective of caste and creed. The inclusion of female porn stars in mainstream Bollywood films is a move to recognize sex workers as professionals through popular culture. With instances of liberated womanhood, Bollywood has shown its commitment to uphold the image of a progressive, liberal, globalized India, committed to preserving the rights of all its citizens, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, and gender identity. However, the other side of this commitment is to critique the lapses in its social, political, judicial, and economic systems, and bring to the fore the dichotomy between theory and praxis. Bollywood might not be empowered to frame policies or laws, yet keeping in view the growing power of news and cultural media over the state, the films in question certainly call for greater state interventions and measures to promote gender equality and resist gender injustices. While it is not possible to discuss these women-centric films in detail in this presentation, but at least some major films which have gained maximum critical and commercial success in drawing attention to the ambiguities of women's issues in today's Indian context can be briefly mentioned. I go to slide number 9. Such films like Queen, 2015, and Piku, also 2015, show that women can be single, independent, and happy at the same time. In films like Der Ishqiya, Parched, Lipstick Under My Burkha, and Ek Ladki Ko Dekha To Aisa Laga, the directors have tried to highlight the recalcitrant sexual orientation of women and how patriarchy tries to suppress them. In these films, the main contention is also to show the ways in which these narratives establish the sexual rights and autonomy of its female characters despite domestic violence, societal odds, and resistance. Moreover, women's biopics like The Dirty Picture, Mary Kom, Dangal, Razi, Manikarnika, and Mission Mangal, among others, have foregrounded the real-life professional and related private struggles of women. Some of these women are also marginal in terms of their class, caste, and provincial positions. And to promote their success stories is also to strike the hornet's nest of traditional hierarchies in Indian society. In Sridevi's comeback vehicle, English Winglish, the female director, Gauri Shinde, has given us the powerful treatment of the domestic woman question by interweaving the issues of language, diaspora, and female subjectivity, and has shown us how significant languages can be a means of a rise of a post-liberal and globalized female individuality. I hope that you can still hear me. Films like Kahani, both 1 and 2, and Mardani, 1 and 2, Jai Gangajal, Bobby Jasus, Revolver Rani, and Chappak, among others, engage with women's courageous involvement in appropriating the male-dominated world of crime. The predictable image of women as victims of male crime have been usually turned upon its head in all these narratives, where most of these women professionally challenge the male predominance and corruption in the dark underbelly of the criminal subcultures. Films like No One Killed Jessica, Gulab Gang, Nirja, Pink, Akira, Matra, Mom, and Thappar have shown how to reverse the process of one-dimensional subjugation of women by hands and exposing the loopholes of the Indian judiciary. These films challenge the divide between the legal, illegal, and focus on women making tough and morally ambiguous choices to resist patriarchal violence. It is interesting to note that these women-centric films have brought women's problems, societal and cultural barriers and obstacles to the forefront, arguing strongly in favor of protest, resistance, and change. But at the same time, they have also veered towards moments of celluloid wish fulfillment by empowering the lead heroine's character with some superhuman and unreal powers to defeat all obstacles. The narratives of Matra, Mom, and Mardani are examples of such filmy heroization of the female protagonist, enabling them to cross hurdles in an absurdly staged and unrealistic ways. Besides, in films like English Winglish, Tanu Veds Manu 2, and Piku, we find certain patriarchal ways of assessing faith in heterosexual marriages, bourgeois domesticity, and normative romantic love are used very deftly to lead the emancipated female protagonist from liberty, singlehood, and rebellion towards conformity and complicity. I go to the 10th slide. Moreover, if we look at films like the Raaz series, Alone, Phobia, Ragini MMS2, that centralize women characters and their traumatic narratives, but their real intention is to sexualize the concept of the supernatural and locate the problematic of female erotics in the confluence of the macabre and the carnal. These recent films have given excessive focus to the issues of sexuality, and in displaying female flesh by putting sexually uninhibited actresses to play the lead role. In this respect, the Sunny Leone films, Jism 2, Mastizade, Leela, etc., that have used the porn star's body to overtly sexualize their product on screen, encouraging us to delineate the ironies of the post-liberal and post-feminist femalehood in Bollywood films. In these films with explicit and exclusive sexual content, the central idea is not to foreground the woman's problems and struggles, but to give a typical erotic pleasure to the male gaze, the male eyes, gazing at the sexual antics of a sexually liberated female protagonist. The female actor might have a pivotal role in the narrative, but all it boils down to is cheap skin show and hollow entertainment. Thus, while there is no dearth of women-oriented cinema in today's Bollywood, highlighting issues of women's equal rights and empowerment and exposing gender bias and stereotyping of Indian patriarchy, they often fall short of the solutions and resolutions to women's problems in reality, and paradoxically endorse the self-contradictory values of a patriarchal society at the cusp of change and modernization. These women-centric films that have released in the last decade apparently create a new wave of post-feminist representation of Indian women in popular culture and media by engaging with the deep-rooted sexist biases and gender stereotyping of mainstream mass culture to create celluloid narratives of gender sensitization and empowerment. However, it is also possible to argue that some of these so-called liberal women-centric films often paradoxically come to terms with the ideological contradictions of the age-old and the sacrosanct institutions of Indian patriarchy and do not prove to be emancipated and path-breaking as they promise to be. At the same time, bringing women-centric subjects to the forefront by using celluloid narratives is a healthy trend that need not be discouraged. Only the filmmakers need to be more critical, daring, realistic, and bold in handling such complicated sociocultural issues. They cannot rely on flat essentialisms and endorse the commodification of women in popular culture, as they need to develop more nuanced and layered narratives to bring out the complexity. You have a Sneha Kaur Chaudhuri's email address on the screen, and we will share the address later as well, so that the participants who may want to get in touch with her later can do so. I end Dr. Sneha Kaur Chaudhuri's presentation with that. I can hardly hear myself because of the rain which is pouring in Siliguri right now. I hope the participants have managed to listen to some parts of the presentation. As we said, we will not have the question and answer session for Dr. Sneha Kaur Chaudhuri's presentation because she is not here to answer your questions. Can I ask Ramkrishna, is Viveka is around? Viveka, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Niklesh, hi.
All right. I'll just introduce you and then we can go into your presentation. If you just allow me to introduce you. Our second speaker today is Viveka Gurung, Assistant Professor of Sociology at Norbahadur Bhandari Degree College in Gangtok, East Sikkim. Her research areas include labor migration, gender, and urban spaces. Today, Viveka will deliver a presentation on the topic Queer and Introduction. Over to Viveka.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Viveka, hello? You can start your presentation.
Yeah. Okay. So, good afternoon to all watching, and thank you very much, Niklesh, for making me a part of this initiative. Yeah. Before we start, I just want to say a few words on the nature of my talk today. After having attended a few webinars myself, I learned that webinars can be very, very tricky, you know, in the sense that it caters to a wide range of audience and a wide range of like heterogeneous audience from all the disciplines, from all ages, which is not the case when we have the usual seminars, you know. So webinars, by virtue, become very transdisciplinary. So when this happens, when things are very transdisciplinary, it is particularly challenging, good also in a way, because, you know, many people are listening and then we get to hear many perspectives. But it becomes challenging when we discuss issues like gender, especially queer, because it requires a set of vocabulary and pre-understood theoretical orientations in order to digest its critical matter. So therefore, for the time we have at hand, I will be introducing the topic queer in the mildest manner possible. It is important to discuss queer in the arena of gender issues because it presents itself as a, it is so for years and years we have discussed like genders, you know, the categorization is problematic, but we have not yet come to a conclusion. So what can we do, you know, what can we do about it, not just functionally but very, very much critically. To be blunt here, queer theory stands as an antithesis to the age-old patriarchal, binary, dual categorization of gender identities. That is, there are only two genders. And the binary setup of binary categorization of gender is such that it allows us to understand only two categories of gender. That is, one is male and other is female, and these categories are quite fixed, you know. So if you are born with a male reproductive organ, you are identified as male, and so you'll be treated like one. And similarly, if you have the female reproductive organ, you have to act and behave like one. The roles of these two categories have been historically and socially created and are considered to be fixed. Now fixed is the word that we have to press on at the moment. So the rule of thumb in the binary system is that no one person can avail both the categories. So to say, these two categories are considered to be mutually exclusive. So however, in binary categorization, the catch is that these two categories are not created equal. Especially in a patriarchal society, basically the whole world at this point of time, males occupy a superior position than women. Now, I will not talk about how male acquired the superior position than women, because, you know, that would mean that we are going back to square one. you know, starting from scratch that, oh yeah, there is inequality and then male is superior. We are not going to venture into that because feminist people have already done that for us. So the other significant rule along with the binary categorization that these roles are two roles and then they are fixed, the other significant rule to remember out here is that is the rule of heteronormativity, saying that only males can have sexual relationship with females. There is nothing doing about it. You can't interchange this, and whoever goes beyond this rule is immediately stigmatized and immediately punished. So there are three things to remember in this binary construct powered by patriarchy. So the three things are, number one, you can be either a man or a woman depending upon your organs. There's no in-betweens. Second, man will only have sexual relationship with woman, from which the new offsprings will be born. And the third, and the most important, is man is more superior to women. So these three rules, where did such rules come from? People may ask, you know, people tend to ask, where did these rules come from, and how in the hell did we come to, you know, impose these rules on ourselves? Well, people believe it is written in the holy texts, and it is the way God intended things to be. But, you know, turns out the new age Indological studies have many different things to say. And viewers can do their own research on this topic. As, you know, just yesterday we had Dr. Gabriella, who actually pointed this fact beautifully, like reinterpreting text, you know, to find new meanings, or, you know, reinterpret the older meanings. So this set of rules, that is these three rules I spoke about, these three set of rules have been followed and reproduced for many centuries, but, you know, with a very dark side to it. And the dark side is that due to the inequality in the power structure between these two categories, one became the exploited and the other became the exploited, which led to a plethora of issues, you know, non-representation, violence, kind, subversion, and the most heinous, you know, of all, like the rape culture, which plagues us all. So until a point, this went on, this set of rules went on until a point where the exploited category, that is the females, raised their voices and decided to put a stop to this mess. The matter is quite simple, you know. If there are two categories in this world, then those categories should be equal, right? I mean, why not? So this was the entry point of, let's say, feminism. The goal was the equality of sexes in socio-economical and political sphere. So wave after wave and struggle after struggle, the feminist agenda, it inched its way to its ultimate goal. First, it was the right to vote, then right to education, then economic parlance, right of self-expression, as Dr. Sneha Kaur, she also had a presentation about. And finally, realization that, you know, these two are not the only categories, and there are many in-betweens. I will not say what are the in-betweens, but let's keep it at that for some point. And there are many in-betweens, like, who were even more marginalized than the women, you know. So merging with them and then fighting for equal rights for everyone, no matter where they came from, what was between their legs, or the color of their skin, etc. Basically, you know, after a point when females started raising their voice that hello, this is not what we are signing up for. We need to take a break from this patriarchal society and delve into deeper matters. Realize that there are there are not just women, but there are also people who don't consider themselves a woman or are not born as women. What about the intersex, you know? What about the transsexuals? What about them? What about those people who are even more marginalized or not even recognized in the society, you know? So this is the point when feminism evolved into intersectional feminism. So intersectional feminism was doing fine for itself, basically because it began to create its own stock of knowledge, you know, like which did not depend upon the patriarchal stock. For example, women can do what men can do. Women need not be what men want them to be, as a male gaze, what Dr. Sneha Kar was also talking about, like we need not look a certain way, we might we don't need to perform a particular set of role of cooking or nurturing or all that. We can be whatever we want to be, you know. So and do what we can. Hello, can you hear me?
We can hear you, Viveka. We can hear you.
Okay. So intersectional feminism, after a point of time, started to create a stock of knowledge which was independent, sort of independent. Of course, there are overlays, but then sort of independent from the patriarchal stock. Meaning to say, we started to create new ideas and ways of thinking which reflected in our daily phenomenon, which was creating new realities every day. You know? And this went on for some time. Of course, there is not just females and the issue of gender in the world. We have a lot of issues going on. A lot of those issues are going like having interventions. There are theoretical groundings of different issues coming up. So, you know, things are going parallelly. It's not just feminism alone being able to achieve all this. Things are going parallelly. So, until very recently in the 1990s, intersectional feminism amalgamated with post-structural theoretical framework. Here, I think I take a moment to say post-structural theoretical framework, what it does, it studies not only the object itself, but the system of knowledge that produced it, okay, which paved material grounds for the birth of this revolutionary, very, very revolutionary critical branch of theory that we come to know today as the queer theory. So people sometimes say, they get confused, you know, even my friends, we have discussions, they say, maybe queer theory is not born of feminism, or if it is born of feminism, how is it different from, you know, other feminist theories, you know? So I'll explain that as we go. So queer theory essentially, in a way, does what Copernicus and later Galileo and the heliocentric gang did for science. You know, they questioned the existing body of knowledge, critically analyzed it, found inconsistencies, and then they debunked it. You know, people were happy before Galileo and Copernicus that, Earth is stationary. Oh, yeah, Earth is stationary. And we are the center of the universe. The sun revolves around us more than 200 years, you know. And the other side of the coin was that whoever holds the power status in Earth, which is the center of the universe, becomes the supreme authority and, you know, is the master of the universe. But when Galileo and his gang came in and said, like, it's actually the other way around, dude, it's not like that. So it totally changed the scientific scenario and even the, you know, human course of human civilization. So in a way, queer theory does what Galileo and the gang did for science. Queer theory arrives at a point and asks, you know, if it's not just, how do I put this? Okay, we have a problem with gender, that gender are unequal. But have you ever stopped for a second and thought, why did we even create the category of gender in the first place? So it not only, queer theory not only studies gender as an object, but it goes all back to understand the genesis of gender as a category in this, in our society. Okay. So, where the, so now I come to talk about the difference between where intersectional feminism stops and then queer theory takes over the baton. Okay. Where the intersectional feminism is limited to the disruption of sexuality and gender, the gender continuum, you know, they still believe in categories. They say that, yeah, there is male, there is, patriarchy was like, there is male and there is female. Feminism comes in and says, there's not just male and female, there are many more categories in between. Okay. Now, intersectional feminism stops at that. Queer theory comes in and says, why the categories in the first place, yo? Why do we need, did we arrive to the idea of these categories? Okay, how we created these categories, and not, it's not just, you know, biology that pushes it. There is a heavy social connotation of these categories, and we must take this opportunity to dig in the history and understand the creation of the idea of the categories. So this is where intersectional feminism and queer theory separates itself, you know. So, yeah. So, but you know, unlike Galileo's case, yeah, physical sciences are different than social sciences. Galileo was like, yeah, people, there is Earth, there is Sun. You can see Earth, you can see Sun. There is an angle. If we are supposed to be stationary, this particular angle should be stationary throughout the year. But when we came aboard and took the remeasurements, the angles were different, and hence proved that Earth is not the center of the universe. But the same thing cannot be done in social sciences, but because most of the things that we have in our in the society are symbols of the symbols that we assign to the environment and not the environment directly. You know, for us social scientists, sun is not just a flame, ball of flame. Okay, sorry, excuse my physics, but yeah, a ball of flame. Sun is God. Sun is the creator of life. You know, sun is warmth and embalming, comforting. It's power. You know. So we don't just understand sun as its objective reality, but there is a lot of subjective reality of the sun, which helps us to ultimately understand the social connotation of the sun, you know. So unlike Galileo, queer theorists can't just jump in and say, either this is gender, this is not gender. That is, you know, it needs a thorough discussion. It needs a thorough discussion, a multi-planar explanation as to why we want to say that gender is a social construct and we can reconstruct it. You know, and this is where people like Judith Butler, Sedgwick, Loretis, and Scott, to name a few, they come with groundbreaking studies. You know, gender trouble. Right now, my mind is not processing, but then audience can look up literature regarding queer theory. Okay, so in my opinion, the three fundamental theoretical pillars which queer theory builds itself are deconstructionism, phenomenology, dispersion of power. Yeah. So Derrida, Foucault, Schultz, Gramsci become a very, very essential background to read. Like without understanding, these fundamental pillars, people might have a tough time digesting what queer theory has to offer. You know. So there are two types of people. Okay, there are two types of people. One who believe that society is like a tree, it grows and it has its own course and all that. And then there are two other type of people who think society is a horse. You know, you need to tug and pull, and then you know. And the one who's sitting on the horse directs the course of the society, which is the horse. You know, so if you are the former who thinks society is a tree and all that, it will be very, very difficult for you to digest this, you know, because you think the society is stationary and things are going to be how they have always been. But if you are the one who knows that society is not a tree and it's a horse, and you can, if you and your ideas are significant enough to be on top of the horse, you shall direct the course of the society. Okay. So, queer theory is just 22 years old. You know, it's just 20. It started in the late 1990s. It's just 22 years old, but it has so much to offer, in the sense that it's like choti mu badi baat kind of. You know, like you want to destroy whatever idea we have of gender. And how do you want to do it, may I ask? Then again, you know, we pull out our friends from behind, post-structuralist friends and phenomenological friends, and then say, yeah, this is it, yeah. And see, Galileo changed the course of theory for science and human society back then with the help of a telescope. We are in 2020. We have a lot of theoretical interventions. We have a lot of study, gender studies going on. You know, we have already established that patriarchy is bad for the society. You know, so we can take it up from there. We can take it. It is possible. It is possible. So if we can put our academic gaze aside, the queer logic is the acknowledgement of the existence of the other, regardless of their identities. Precisely because identities are created and are... Now, how identities are created and fluid, I cannot explain to you in this 20 minutes. You have to read up on Butler, Sedgwick, Simone de Beauvoir, phenomenology and all that. Okay. So... where was I? Precisely because identities are created and fluid. So this logic is liberating because it allows people to exist in any form of permutation and combination of categories. You know, so you can be a black male, cisgender male, bisexual, allowed. You can be non-binary, lesbian, transvestite, allowed. Because these genders, these categories are created, and, you know, we can reshape our worlds to fit these categories. So again, this idea of whole queer theory is liberating because, one, it allows you to exist in any form you want, unless, of course, you are harming someone. Yes, it allows you to exist in any form without any stigmatization. Okay, and the next very good thing it does is if you are just emerging as a new category, you don't have to go all over, you know, the whole cycle of, oh, recognize me, and oh, my struggle, and oh, you know, the entire thing that females have already done that for you. You know, the feminists have already done that for you. In 200 years, we have already gone through that struggle, and you don't want to go through it all again just because there's a new category to be identified. You know? So if you just take the word and understand that these categories are fluid and we can do without it, it makes life easy for, you know, many people who think society is a horse, but not for people who think society is a tree. Okay, so that is why most of the people who are from the LGBTQ plus community, QIA plus, you don't have to go like LGBTQIA plus, umbrella term, queer, you know, it facilitates your existence, because to be added into that LGBTQIA plus, you would again have to stand up for your rights, again have to, you know, say that I exist, go through all that burden again. Umbrella term queer, you know, helps many of us. So, you know, to conclude, I don't want to be very academic and all that, because, you know, academia is nothing if it is not in praxis and you don't, you know, put it, you don't utilize it in your own life. You know, I can be talking about queer theory and then I myself might be like, I have to go because I have to cook dinner and all that, no, because I'm a girl. Jokes aside, anyway, so every time I hear very, very casually, okay, I say this very, very casually. Every time I have heard the problems, like, let's say, if not gender, environmental problems, okay? Oh, there is so many plastic straws in the ocean. What do we do about it? Then people say, you have to change your mindset. Then, oh, there is so much of commercialization and then commodification. People are into capitalism too much. And what do we do? And I've always heard it again. Oh, you have to change. The answer is always the same, you know. Oh, you have to change the mindset. So queer theory actually has put its foot forward and is going towards changing the mindset. And where, meaning, go back all the way, take gender as a historic point of historical analysis, and then start the very, very first day when the idea of male as a category was created, or female as a category was created, and how this categorization led to power inequalities, you know, how these categories feed the power structure. And queer theory comes in as, we can dismantle this power structure if we dismantle the categories. And I think that is that.
Your last concluding part, I can point to one question from Vishwajit Das, who says, is there anything wrong in categorization in terms of gender if there is no exploitation based on gender biasness?
Is it possible to view yeah. That question on my screen, please?
Yeah, we are trying to get it. Not this one. There is another one which says, also by Vishwajit Das, my question to Professor Viveka is there anything wrong in categorization in terms of gender if there persists no exploitation based on gender biases? In the sense that this
okay.
question is...
If the categories can exist... If the categorization is okay, if there is no discrimination.
Yes.
Okay? So, That is a good question. I feel that when categorization, then if you have taken out the discrimination part, then what is the again use of having categorization over again? No, the discrimination part comes because of the categorization. If you removing the discrimination, there will be no categorization in search in the first place.
Okay.
That is queer theory.
Right. I think you have answered Phalguni Bhattacharya's question. He said, what is the best way to reconstruct the gender according to your opinion? But because you're saying that you are not into constructions, you're not trying to have these gender constructs at all. So I think that would, am I right in interpreting your presentation that we really don't need
yes,
to find
Yes, of
right?
course. Sir. So he's asking, how do we construct the whole thing?
Right. Can you see the question?
We don't reconstruct the whole thing. Actually, we deconstruct it.
Mm-hmm.
There are people, there are literatures coming about, there are terminologies coming about, which are very gender neutral, you know, the like pronouns like them, it, where you don't denote anyone's gender, you know. So you take a person for the qualification like of a person, and you don't. So people are trying to deconstruct, and there is a whole new pedagogy coming about for to promote gender neutrality, let's say, you know. How can we understand things devoid of gender? I would also like to point out here, this is extremely difficult because gender differences and sexual differences are more, what do you say, fundamental than even caste differences, even religious differences. You know, gender differences and sexual differences are deep in our language, deep in our objects. Like in Hindi, there is like darwaja khula tha, and darwaja becomes male, and then khidki khuli hai, and khidki becomes female, you know. So it will obviously take a lot of effort from the literature party also here to come up with a language which accommodates everybody without using the categories.
All right, and presentation, I will stick to one last question. This is again from Joyashree Mukherjee. She's sticking to gender binary, and she's saying, what is patriarchal about the gender binary? Does the matrilineal communities do not believe in the binary categorization of gender? The fact that you are also sort of connecting patriarchy with the gender binary. Joyashree Mukherjee is asking the question, what about matrilineal societies? They also believe in gender binaries, right?
Yeah, matrilineal society, of course, they believe in gender binary, but then the power relation is slightly different than the patriarchal society. As in, you know, females are given a different set of power relations as compared to the patriarchal women. So they do believe in gender binary. It's not that they have decategorized the, genders.
Right. Thank you, Vivek. And I think it will, your presentation will provoke a lot of other responses and questions. But just for time constraint, we will move on to the next presentation by Noor Rizvi. Noor, if you can hear me, just allow me to give a short introduction of yours, and then we will move on to your presentation. Thanks, Viveka, by the way. The last but not definitely the least is Noor Rizvi, our presenter for the final presentation today. Noor is a doctoral fellow at Aligarh Muslim University. She is a Fulbright FLTA scholar Hindi an alumni at Kansas University, where she was between 2018 and 2019. NOOR's research attempts to find out the scope of English language teacher training in madrasa education. Her presentation today is titled Gender Stereotypes and Women Empowerment. Does madrasa education matter? Over to Ms. Rizvi. NOOR, there is one thing, if you can switch off the fan, which is probably, is there a fan there at your place, which is switched on?
Yes.
It's creating a slight problem. Sorry, NOOR, we are really putting you in the hot seat, but thanks a lot. Now the voice is, the sound is much better. Thank you, NOOR. You can start.
So thank you, Niklesh. Am I audible? Okay. So.
NOOR, I believe you will also try and share your screen, right?
Yes, I want to share a PPT.
I'm just requesting Ramkrishna, who is backstage. NOOR Rizvi will try to share her screen. If you can just see that it's showing.
Okay, fine.
Yes, NOOR, something is being shared. It's just taking a little time to sync.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. Now, if you can go to the slideshow, you won't be able to see yourself. We will be able to see you. I hope you will have this. You will not have the same problems that I had.
Thank you so much, Niklesh. And good afternoon, everyone. Good evening. And I really like to, congratulate all the speakers. They talk on the various topics. And unfortunately, due to some reason, I just attended. So today I'm going to present on gender stereotypes and women empowerment. Does madrasa education matter? So first I would like to explain two key terms, defining the two key terms. First is madrasa education. I'm sure most of the people are familiar with madrasa education, but madrasa education is an Arabic word for a school. It is not used for literal Arabic meaning, but as a system of education with core emphasis on Arabic literacy, Islamic values, and Islamic religion. And my second key term is gender stereotype. A gender stereotype generalizes about the gender attributes, differences, and the role of individual or groups. So the introduction of we can take a World Bank development report shows that in many developing countries, governments are increasingly collaborating with non-state providers to expand educational opportunities to girls from marginalized communities. For instance, the madrasa education system in Indonesia, Nigeria, Bangladesh serve as low-cost platform to achieve universal education and the target of gender equity in schooling. This strategy has been supported by international development agencies. School education is expected to provide gender equitable outcomes. Greater educational provision can reduce violence within marriage, increase participation in paid work, and help break down restrictive social norms and gender perceptions, such as entry of women into male occupations, such as politics. Female schooling is also widely believed to delay marriage and improve women's status within the household, thereby creating a virtuous circle between education and gender equality.
Noor, just interrupting you once, can you just try and make the presentation full screen, as in as a slideshow?
Yes, is it not visible?
No, at the moment it's not. What you need to do is maybe go back to the screen share option. I think that will be the problem. Go back to the screen share option on StreamYard and ask for the presentation to be shared.
Is that it? Sir. Just full screen korte hobe. Screen ta just ye hoye ache.
নূর বলছেন যে উনি করেছেন ফুল স্ক্রিন কিন্তু আমরা বোধহয় ওনার ইয়েটা দেখতে পাচ্ছি জাস্ট ট্রাই দ্য ফুল স্ক্রিন দেয়ার ইয়েস ইয়েস নাও ইটস পারফেক্ট নাও ইটস পারফেক্ট থ্যাংক ইউ নূর থ্যাংক ইউ রামকৃষ্ণ
So I would like to continue. There's evidence and some research which shows, which suggests that secular school paradoxically can reproduce exclusive gender norms and prepare girls for traditional social roles. This is partially because school textbooks around the developing world portray women in traditional occupational roles and encourage stereotypes regarding the division of labor within a marriage. Equally, madrasa education is widely held to reinforce traditional values in girls in ways that they may have substantial returns in the marriage market by helping them become a better wife. Quote unquote, Raynaud 2005. There is evidence to indicate significant conservatism amongst female madrasa graduates in relation to women's role. Supporting a traditional patriarchal social structure where boys are preferred and supported both for higher education and employment, while girls play a homemaking role. As low-cost schools such as madrasas are increasingly relied upon to promote universal schooling, the full implications of their impact on values and attitude need to be better understood. And in India particularly, as I said, this is the report from World Development Report 2011 and UNDP report shows this. But in India, there are important differences within the Islamic faith education sector that create variation in the degree to which Islamic schools are regulated. Madrasas without state recognition are free to teach their own curricula that can vary according to their funding and support base. These madrasas limit interaction between student and teachers of opposite sex, and the curriculum may not explicitly knowledgeable women's role in the politics and the economy. So the role of women in politics and economy is completely missing in the curriculum. Also, a significant number of madrasa graduates take up jobs in mosques and madrasas across the country and make up for the large communities of imams and maulvis. So mostly what happened, the product of madrasa education or madrasas, they are not going they are not going outside the madrasa education. They prefer to work as imams, maulvis inside the madrasa. So their limitation, so their boundary, they're very bound to have very small and confined area. Therefore, what happens inside the madrasa is important not just for the economy, but also in terms of implication for the persistence of the patriarchal norms and attitude in the society. By contrast, like we have two types of madrasa education in India. One is government-based madrasa education, one is non-government-based madrasa education. So what happened, by the contrast, in the government-based madrasas or government-aided madrasas, curricula of recognized madrasas are reviewed by government authorities and mandated to include mathematics, science education, as well as reproductive health education. Thus, there exist three different school types with important differences in the material taught as well as in the value imparted. A school may also vary in the quality of education imparted, with the recognized madrasas having the most variability in funding level and quality. So the main idea behind is that in India we have the madrasa education is very common term we use, but there's various thoughts behind it. There's a various school and section behind it, madrasa education, like government-aided madrasas, non-government-aided madrasas, and their curriculum and their syllabus are quite different in nature. So there's a small share video. I don't know it's going to play or not, but I would like to play this. This is not working due to some technical problem. Okay, so I would like to further proceed to the research area. This is the context of the study. This is the district Siddharthnagar in Uttar Pradesh. And the reason of the selection of district Siddharthnagar is because it's extremely poor district of Uttar Pradesh, where most of the Muslim masses, especially Muslims masses, are you know, dependent on madrasa education and state government schools. So mostly we have state government schools or we have madrasa education. Siddharthnagar district is considered one of the educational backward district of Uttar Pradesh. It is ranking among 34th district in Uttar Pradesh and currently receiving BRGF, that is Backward Region Grant Fund Program under the Ministry of Panchayati Raj 2006. Its population growth is 25.17% in 2001 to 2011, and the sex ratio is 970 females for every 1,000 males. And the literacy rate of Siddharthnagar is 67.81%. So database and methodology of the research is that the research study has been conducted in 5 blocks of district Siddharthnagar, included Naugarh, Shaharatgarh, Bansi, Itwa and Dumariaganj. The madrasas selected for the study are government and non-government both madrasas, and mostly the government aided madrasas are affiliated to Uttar Pradesh Madhyamik Shiksha Board, that is called UP Board. So the present study is entirely based on primary data collected through extensive and intensive level of fieldwork at a different ground. And we use two tools while collecting the data. The first one is teacher questionnaire. So we try to, you know, take the interviews of, you know, teacher student and the focus group discussion. And the subject is that respondent are 1 to 20 madrasa students and including 50 teachers also. So we try to survey and conduct, as I said, that 5 blocks of Siddharthnagar. And the methodology behind is that we use mixed criteria method of sampling. During the survey, the selection of the population was followed to the criteria of convenient sampling. As I said, that it's very, very hard for me to enter in the madrasa education, actually, because most of the madrasa are, you know, boys madrasas and girls madrasas. And I personally haven't seen any madrasa in my district that is that, you know, provide co-ed education. So I try to collect convenient sampling in my methodology. In focus group discussion, the respondent have chosen based on convenience sampling again. And during the interview, the researcher followed purposive sampling criteria. So data interpretation and analysis was very easy because it has been analyzed into various stages in district Siddharthnagar. And I followed the mixed design for collection of data, combining the qualitative data and individual focus group discussions. So the findings, and I would like to also talk about the, you know, when I went to field study, I encountered a lot of problems. So I try to take a number of madrasa students and try to make a WhatsApp group and try to, you know, have focused discussion in that way. So it was quite challenging for me to collect data in that way. So finding of the study is, these are the findings which I have taken interviews and, you know, have an focus group discussion with the students and with the teachers. So the finding shows that first, madrasa may provide limited secular education, which leaves their student particularly vulnerable to patriarchal narratives on gender role and customs. And the madrasa curriculum may not acknowledge and address issue of gender inclusion and can alienate even girls within the co-education classrooms. Women may educated about family and well-being of children as their primary obligation, thereby reinforcing the role of women as homemaker and mothers. The curricula may represent women in a discriminatory way or portray girls in a, you know, very different way and traditional gender stereotypes. So overall, what I want to say that what I found in their syllabus, that it's very, very, you know, it shows a very different role of women in the society, just as a role of homemaker or mothers, or, you know, women who will only serve their husband and all. So the second finding shows that madrasa may differ significantly regarding gender norms and practices. So most co-educational recognized madrasas implemented and Islamic dress code in the absence of. So here I want to make one clarification. This is I'm talking about not a madrasa, but these are madaris. So those are giving the primary education to the just from till class 5th or till class 6th. So they are very giving basic education. So I found a few madaris with co-ed education in my area. So they have they have very Islamic dress and absence of government prescribed rules, because they are non-recognized madrasas. Also, most madrasas impose gender specific restrictions on teaching and learning practices and on campus social interaction, which may indirectly reinforce certain form of gender inequality as a socially acceptable. So The third problem which I have seen is that teacher facilitate the formulation of a student's attitude through the social channel, attitude and influence of the teacher, gender differences. This is actually under quotation. And to extend, teachers in non-religious and religious schools differ in attitudes. School-specific differences in student attitude can prevail despite the use of state-approved curriculum. Madrasa teachers are relatively untrained compared to non-madrasa schools, and as such may lack adequate preparation to understand and address gender dimensions of school and classroom interaction. So the main issue and main problem behind it, what I found while I was taking interview of teachers, that they are undertrained. They didn't have any training, and teacher training is missing. In service teacher is not there. Pre-service, most of the madrasa teachers are untrained, and even they don't have professional degree. They are just master passed out. They have bachelor's degree. So they need to have, adequate training and preparation, which will address gender dimensions. The fourth findings is that traditional madrasa educate students in a restricted environment with limited exposure to working women. So as we know, they have a few restrictions. They have they are not very much connected to the world. So the student therefore tend to grow up to the segmented society, live in a close communities, and devote a significant amount of time to religious activities and studies. They lack exposure to the secular media, I can also say social media, and any type of channel, internet, and what is going happening around the world. So they are not much, they have no exposure to have worldwide or global news. So this is the problem I found while I was taking interview. Madrasa youth in rural communities are socialized to behave according to religious values by means of education system. So mostly in the rural communities, they have religious values, and they just feel not equal to gender, and they have to follow those principles and values. And the research the researcher examined data on teachers and female graduate to explore variation in attitudes across secondary school and state recognized madrasa, that is again the UP board madrasas, towards working mothers, higher education for girls, and political regimes. they found that madrasa graduates were less in favor of higher education for girls, and working mothers consider housewife best for the raising children and indicate a preference for large families. So they have this mentality. I try to check, you know, some madrasa graduate pass out, or madrasa, you know, madrasa graduate mothers, and they believe that you know, married in early age and having a big family and a housewife is the best way to, you know, raise a child. However, they neither look at unrecognized madrasas nor address the issue of gender gap in their attitudes. Therefore, we revisited the issue using a more comprehensive data set that allows comparison of student attitudes by gender and school types, and test some of the pathways underlying the madrasa effect on the gender issues. So I'm coming to the conclusion of the of my research that what I found during so women in developing countries face multiple constraints, so that relaxing just one may not improve gender outcomes. In the presence of social stereotypes among men against women's ability, improved economic opportunity per percent is sufficient to ensure progressive in female empowerment and participation in politics and higher education. So in this context, increasing girls' school participation can help close the gender gap in the society, and it promotes you know, inclusive and pro-social attitudes. Our research also highlights the limited transformational capacity of schooling when girls are educated in madrasas. So the evidence presented suggests that madrasa schools may be imposing their own conservative social norms on students, and they may be catering to the, you know, preferences of some conservative household and promoting values and that are, you know, that are very much, you know, found in rural settings and rural areas. The other issue of policy relevance is the growing concern over the gender stereotypes, is the textbook contents. As I said previously also, that when I analyzed few syllabus of you know, madrasa students, especially I analyzed their English curriculum. So what I found is that the persistence of traditional gender stereotypes among the school going children in our study can you know, partially arise because textbook disseminate gender bias through stereotypes, depiction of men and women within the school curriculum, or we can say in madrasa curriculum. So this is in turn reinforces traditional gender stereotype among students. Therefore, critical reflection is required in this whole issue, and gender contents of teaching and learning material used in textbook as well. As so we need to first revise the syllabus, because this is what syllabus shows, that you know, women should be only become a good mother, good wife, but she cannot be perform like a, you know, good leader or good business woman. So we need to focus on first the curriculum and syllabus of the madrasa, and greater presence of female teachers, better teacher training. And the second problem which most of the teachers encountered, that they didn't have any teacher training. In Siddharth Nagar madrasa, mostly teachers are teacher only get training from DIET. And DIET are actually, it's not very, very, you know, madrasa specific orientation training for teachers. It's overall training for teachers. And they have complained that they did not have any, you know, training curriculum or training teacher training program. So the greater presence of female teachers and better teacher training and introduction of gender balanced teaching. So it should be the gender balanced teaching. And learning material and textbook can help close gender and school madrasa gaps in a student attitude. So this is what is my findings. And I also wanted to show a video. Actually, this video was very interesting, but due to some technical problem, this video did not play. So this video is actually from Afghanistan. And we know that in Afghanistan, there's a lot of issues of, you know, madrasa education, that girls are not allowed to go to schools and all. So what it says about that, that in girls' madrasa, the teachers are teaching behind the wall. So there's a big wall box, and the teacher is citing, you know, secular schools and religious school behind the wall. And students are, you know, girls are sitting in a different room. So they taught in that way. The problem is that, you know, in India also a few madrasas, not a lot of, but in Siddharth Nagar, few madrasas I saw that there's a male teacher and they are teaching and there's a curtain. There's a curtain, you know, while they are teaching. So I believe that face-to-face interaction was missing. And this is the biggest problem, you know, because this create also a hesitation in student. They feel hesitant to, you know, feel more comfortable and more focus on their, you know, learning. So this is what I wanted to show in that video, but because of some problem, it didn't play. So, yeah. So thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Noor. And in fact, okay, since trying to play the video will require more sort of technical juggling here, I would go to some of the questions which are being asked by the participants. There is okay. Pinky Bharadwaj has asked a question. I do not have the question right in front of me right now, but she's asking whether are madrasas doing enough to improvise and update their sort of curriculum to make it more or rather make it less gender discriminatory? Is there an attempt made by madrasas to do that?
Okay, so the question, what I understand that is madrasa has initiative any attempt to reduce, you know, gender differences in through their curriculum and syllabus.
Yeah.
Okay. So as I said that, you know, madrasa, the biggest problem in madrasa is because I have done my research in madrasa education in teacher training program, but not in. So the biggest thing is that we try to evaluate and study the madrasa curriculum. But again, there's no fixed syllabus for madrasa education. So even non-government aided madrasas, they are on different philosophy. They are on different philosophy, like they are on, some madrasas are following Barelvi philosophy of education. That is actually Islamic philosophy. And some are following Deobandi, some are following Shia philosophy. So they did not have any fixed syllabus and curriculum, as I'm taking the syllabus of English. So the government has taken initiative, not Indian government, but also, you know, World Bank and UNDP and, you know, Indian government through modernization of madrasa program. And you know, they try to bridge this gap between, you know, the gender gap. But I'm not very much because since I evaluate and study a syllabus of class 9th and 10th of UP board madrasa, and I'm not very well satisfied you know, as with their syllabus. And I hope there should be more research and there should be more, you know, initiative, because madrasa education is somehow marginalized institution, and it needs more, you know, more research and more initiative and more project to uplift that state of society.
Right. Before I go to the next question, Noor, I would just like to tell our participants, I know that some of you are getting a little worried about the feedback link. We will provide the feedback link at the end of the show again, and so that you can fill it up and ensure that you get your e-certificate of participation. I'm just asking my our participants to be a little patient. We will definitely fix it if there is a problem. Noor, there is another question from Dr. Pushpita Sengupta, which is also tied to what you said. Is there any need to continue madrasa schools when there are many government schools? Is continuing the supporting of madrasa, does it support a religious mentality? That's the question from Dr. Pushpita Sen Gupta.
Nikhilesh, I'm sorry, but can you say it again? I did not understand her question.
Is there any need to continue madrasa schools when there are so many government schools? Do you think the madrasa education system supports a religious mentality?
Actually, that's a very good question, and I think it's a very hot topic of debate, you know, on various channels. I think why not? Because we need an education system that will support, that will fit to a degree of, you know, religious education. But religious education does not mean that you will leave the secular education, you know. You will not, you cannot isolate anyone from the world. Like, only you can give a talim of Quran and Hadith, but that person is complete, you know, alien. He does not know about technology. He does not know about what is going on. And various issues. So I think the madrasa should be modernized. I think there's a it should be modernized according to the latest curriculum, you know, followed by state government, followed by other, you know, government. Like, every government has different syllabus system, like West Bengal has different and UP board has different. But there should be a degree to fit between religious education and the secular education. So I believe there is, obviously, because, you know, we are not familiar with this thing, but Sachar Committee report and Justice Verma Committee report shows that madrasas are, you know, educating large section of the, you know, society. And especially it's educating the Muslim community of the society, which is one of the most backward, you know, section in our country. Even the condition of Muslim section is worse than ST, SC, OBC. So I think madrasas are really playing very important role, but it should be, you know, it should be modernized and it should be, you know, updated time to time.
Another thing, Noor, you said that how the madrasa system also plays an important role in universal schooling. It sort of helps in bringing some of the people who wouldn't have got into schools otherwise. And there is a question from Prahlad Kumar. This is a question from Sili Gupta, who says, what measures or steps should be taken to enroll more girls in schools, as most Muslim girls are deprived of education? And do you think that the madrasa education system fills this gap in some way?
Okay, right. Yeah. Again, I'm quoting, you know, Sachar Committee report that shows that Muslim women are, you know, like, I don't remember the exact number, but one of the least enrolled women, you know, in higher education especially. And I think definitely it's a need of our to do some initiative. And the thing is that I'm not very much satisfied with the, you know, idea or philosophy behind the madrasa education, because somehow it has some rigid philosophy and they are not ready to have changes. You know, change is everywhere. Even in NCRT syllabus, in state government, we do changes. National Curriculum Framework changed their syllabus. Like in English language teaching, suppose I'm giving an example, small example. Like we have a syllabus, you know, we study English as a grammar translation method. But now we focus on communicative language teaching. So we change. It changed from teacher oriented to, you know, learner center, more learner center. So I think somehow, you know, few leaders also try to, you know, implement new curriculum, new training, because her question is, you know, let me back to this point that teacher trainings are very important, because a student go to madrasa education and teachers are not trained. They are teaching the same thing. They are teaching the same syllabus in the way they learn things. So I think a teacher training is very important. And now everything is digitalized in COVID time. You know, it's very easy for teachers, even madrasa education, to just download an app and they will learn so many things from, you know, American embassies and British Council. You know, I'm talking about in English context, but I think there's a lot of possibilities are also in different discipline. So this, you know, government is definitely doing, but also we need to also do some initiative. And the problem, the biggest problem is, even I'm giving again an example, like a guy who is graduated, or is a girl who is graduated from Madrasa, from Baralvi Madrasa, it's a different school of thought. And she, if she is applying in Shia Madrasa for a job, they will not accept, they will not, you know, approve their degree. So within a Madrasa, they have a lot of conflicts. So first of all, you know, there's a problem that they will solve within a madrasa, and then there's a, you know, comparison between state government schools and, you know, private schools and madrasa school. And definitely I personally do believe that madrasa can do a lot of changes, but first it need to be changed.
All right, yeah, thank you Noor. Well, we've come to the end of our almost towards the end of our webinar. I would just ask Ram Krishna, who is backstage, is Dr. Jayanta Mukherjee on the platform? He is supposed to give the vote of thanks at the end of the session. Ram Krishna, Jayanta Babu ki achen? হ্যাঁ, জয়ন্তবাবু এসছেন। জয়ন্তবাবু, আপনি আমার কথা শুনতে পাচ্ছেন?
হ্যাঁ, শুনতে পাচ্ছি নিখিলেশ।
আচ্ছা, থ্যাংক ইউ। ইউ আর জাস্ট ইন টাইম ফর দি ভোট অফ থ্যাঙ্কস। আপনি যদি দয়া করে ভোট অফ থ্যাঙ্কস দেন।
ওকে। অনারেবল স্পিকার্স, ডিস্টিংগুইশড গেস্টস and most valued participants. It's my privilege to have been asked to propose a vote of thanks on this occasion. I, on behalf of Acharya Sukumar Sen Mahavidyalaya and Birpara College Alipurduar and our entire team, and on my own behalf, extend a happy, very hearty vote of thanks to all the speakers for gracing their important works and sharing with us their findings and opinions today. A big thank you to Dr. Nikhilesh Bhattacharya of Birpara College for his superb anchoring. I may like to express our sincere thanks to Dr. Dil Kumar Pradhan, teacher in charge of Birpara College, to make this event a grand success. Finally, I would like to take this opportunity to place on record our hearty thanks to Belur Ramakrishna Vidya Mandir Educational and Cultural Session for providing us technical support. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, I want to state that we are all most grateful to all our speakers on this stage. We thank you for being with us this afternoon. It has been a great pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Mukherjee, and thanks a lot. Special thanks to, of course, the speakers Viveka and Noor, who were with us today. Two messages to the participants who are here. One, we are trying to give the feedback form on the chat box. I believe I'm not completely aware of what has been happening on the chat box because I've been in the studio virtually, but in case there is a problem, we will definitely ensure that all of you who are here today will get the feedback form. And on the basis of the feedback form, an e-certificate will be auto-generated and sent to your mail address. So when you submit the feedback form, please ensure that you you give the correct email address of yourself. It might take a few days. I mean, you know that we are getting used to these technologies. It's taking time. We are certainly not experts in these things. It might take a little bit of time, but we can assure everyone who has attended the webinar, who have watched the live streaming, you will be given your certificates based on the feedback form. So you will also have access to the feedback forms in one form or the other. Please be patient, be in touch with us, and we will, over the next few days, ensure this thing. The second matter is what we talked about at the beginning of today's session, that there will be another session on the 26th of July, which will be an interactive session involving a psychiatrist and a clinical psychologist. They will talk about how to de-stress in times of distress, which is what we are faced with at the moment. All of you, please we would be very happy if you register for that event as well. That is going to be held on Sunday, 26th of July, from 3 p.m. onwards. That's it from us for today. If you have questions, etc., further questions beyond the webinar, you have our email addresses. Please get in touch. You have our phone numbers as well. And that's it. Thank you. Thank you so much for being with us today. Thank you.